Everyone loves Batman the Animated Series, and I mean
EVERYONE!
It's one of the few, if not the only Batman animated show that is universally loved across the board, except for one thing. The new Batman Adventures is a 1987 animated TV show, but for the vast majority of people, this show is best known as the final season of Batman the Animated Series, and that is not exactly accurate. Batman the Animated Series lasted for 4 years and 85 episodes between 1992 and 1995, and it's always because of these 85 episodes that the show is best remembered for. But then 2 years later, in 1997, the new Batman Adventures happened, and it became part of BTAS, even though it's clearly not. Or is it? I'm not entirely sure when this became such a controversial topic, but there are overly dramatic videos dedicated to illustrate how Batman the Animated Series died because of the new Batman Adventures. And while I can totally see why some people may think that, I'm not going to sit here and say that the new Batman Adventures was a mistake.
You wouldn't.
On the contrary, this whole controversy makes me think that, with the new Batman Adventures, everyone missed the point. If you've ever enjoyed a TV show from beginning to end, you've probably noticed that there are certain things that don't change. The characters, the places, the stories, the tone, and in the case of animated shows, the character designs and art direction are things that almost never change. This consistency is what determines the long-term success of a series, because if any of those things changes, the series becomes unfamiliar and people may lose interest in the show. When the creators of a show decide to make a permanent change to any of these things, they have to create a brand new show which becomes a distinctly separate project from the original series. This has been standard practice for TV shows pretty much since they were created, and that's why the new Batman Adventures is the most unique show in the history of television. The series presents itself as the final season of Batman the Animated Series, despite being an almost completely different show. Never before in history has a series changed so much between seasons, and that's likely the reason why many people just don't like the new Batman Adventures. On IMDb, BTAS holds a near-perfect score of 9 out of 10, while TNBA scores an 8.4. So why exactly people don't love TNBA as much as BTAS? The obvious answer would be the new visual style, art direction, and character designs, which are drastically different. After all, when you first have a Riddler that looks like a menacing gangster from the 1940s, wearing a tailor-made elegant suit with a hat that hides his face in shadows, and then you turn that into this.
Hey diddle diddle, time for a riddle.
It's not gonna go well. But the character designs are only the tip of the iceberg when it comes to understanding why TNBA didn't resonate with audiences as much as BTAS. The new Batman Adventures shares the same opening of Batman the Animated Series, promising the viewer an experience similar to that of the first season. But then the show starts in a completely different reality. Not only do the characters look different, but some of them are completely new, like Tim Drake, the new Robin.
Excuse me?
Oh no.
As a viewer, it's impossible not to feel a jarring disconnection between the last episode of BTAS and the first episode of TNBA. And the frustrating part about this radical change is how little explanation there is for this new status quo. In BTAS, storytelling was always first and foremost. When they introduced Batgirl, she didn't just suddenly appear in one episode. Barbara Gordon first started showing up as a supporting character, and her role as Batgirl was slowly developed throughout multiple episodes. This approach was completely abandoned in TNBA, with both the new Robin and also Nightwing showing up as fully fleshed characters without any sort of background beyond the episode Scenes of the Father and Old Wounds, which briefly explain how Dick Grayson stopped being Robin and Tim Drake assumed the role. The complete background of the new Robin and Nightwing was actually told in a comic book miniseries called The Batman Adventures: The Lost Years, a series that tries to bridge the gap between both series, but ultimately fails to explain the visual changes, and it only created more confusion about the continuity. Nevertheless, the miniseries was at some points much more interesting than the series itself, because it was focused on storytelling, showing us the gradual collapse of the Batman and Robin partnership, the slow integration of Batgirl into the Batman family, and the complete background development of Tim Todd. I mean, Jason Drake. Dang it. Tim Drake, a character whose origin is almost exactly like Jason Todd's origin from the comics. But because Tim Drake was the Robin of the comics at the time, well, you get the idea. The point is that the storytelling and character moments from the lost years is what people expected from the new Batman adventures, but unfortunately that wasn't the case. It almost feels as if the writers of TNBA didn't want to put much effort into creating new stories, with episodes like Holiday Nights, Joker's Millions and Mad Love being direct adaptations of pre-existing comics, as well as the episode Judgment Day, where Two-Face creates a third identity for himself in order to stop his own crimes in a plot that is just way too similar to the 1986 story called Janus from Shadow of the Bat number 62. Not to mention Legends of the Dark Knight, an episode that recreates the 1940s Batman comics, The Dark Knight Returns, as well as bearing too many similarities with the 1973 story called The Batman Nobody Knows from Batman number 250 and the 1986 story called The Stories from Legends of the Dark Knight number 94. Now, some of the best episodes of BTAS are also comic book adaptations. But the difference is that in BTAS they didn't just adapt the story verbatim, but rather found ways to improve upon the original stories, whereas in TNBA it's almost like reading the comics. I'm not saying that there was a lack of creativity, but rather that it was not properly used. The new and creative elements established in TNBA consisted mostly of strange dynamics between characters that were just flat out wrong. Batman and Batgirl become a lot more flirtatious in this show, hinting that there is something more between them, while Catwoman and Nightwing straight up make out. These weird ideas were exclusively introduced in this show, as the creators decided to establish their own universe under their own rules, which is another source of controversy, because back in BTAS, they were faithful to the established Batman mythos. But those days were over. This was no longer a show about dramatic stories of the underworld of Gotham and the never-ending quest of the tormented hero against the street-level criminals. The new Batman Adventures is a showcase of the more fantastic supervillains and their evil master plans, culminating in epic climactic battles, with spectacular fights and a glorious display of action, explosions, and destruction. A show that focuses a lot more on the action side of the stories, rather than the psychological and human side, which makes all the spectacle feel shallow and hollow. A clear example of this being The Ultimate Thrill, an episode that is an entire action set piece from beginning to end, with little depth or meaning behind the action or motivations of the main villain. TNBA is a show that features episodes with funny musical montages, showing the villains being cute and harmless, and Batman being angry at them because of that. Episodes that transform original characters from BTAS into unrecognizable versions of themselves. A Batman show where Batman is no longer the center of attention, but rather a grim and stoic father figure to the more colorful members of the Batman family, as well as a cornerstone to the larger DC universe, with other characters that are not part of the Batman mythos showing up for unexpected cameos. A Batman that is much more dependent on his gadgetry and technology, overusing his new Bat jetpack to fly around Gotham as if he was Superman, or getting his own fireproof batsuit to fight Firefly. Both of these things created specifically for this show, and most likely to sell toys. Considering how much Warner Bros. Wanted to make toys out of their movies and TV shows, I wouldn't be surprised if the main motivation behind the new character designs was simply to create a new line of toys. Unfortunately, some of the new character designs completely missed the mark. Like Baby Doll, for instance, a character that in BTAS looked like an adorable toddler, but who was in fact an adult trapped in a childlike body. The conflict of this character represented both internally and externally to create one of the most tragic, powerful, and appealing characters of the show. In the new Batman Adventures, however, the tragedy is actually what they did to this once great character, in what is, in my opinion, the worst episode of the series.
Sorry, I didn't mean to.
But there are some new designs that actually work, one of them being the Scarecrow, a character who is no longer a cartoon version of the comic book character, but actually his own dark and twisted version, which makes sense because of the dark nature of the new Scarecrow stories. Part of the reason why the episodes Over the Edge and Never Fear work is because of the new Scarecrow's character design. These stories just wouldn't have worked with the previous BTAS style, and that's why I think that some of the new character designs should not be as problematic as people make them out to be.
Yeah!
The difference between a good character design and a bad one in this show boils down to how much the changes make sense in context with the stories being told, with Batgirl being the perfect example of a good character redesign. Batgirl became much more sleek, with a better looking batsuit all around, and it makes sense, because she is now an official member of the Batman family, which gives her access to the unlimited resources of Batman, and that comes along with a better batsuit. The Joker stories are also not nearly as dark as they were in BTAS, so his new cartoony character design fits quite nicely. Same thing goes for Catwoman and the Penguin, with the stories of both characters working better than they would have had with their old character designs. They are all basically new characters, so the new character designs work. Batman, for instance, becomes more one-dimensional, because unfortunately they stripped away most of his compassionate and human side, but his new monochromatic batsuit would reflect this change, so it works.
Just like old times.
The new designs are jarring, for sure, and some of them don't necessarily work unless they have a good story. Mr. Freeze, Killer Croc, and the Riddler are all characters whose new designs don't work because they have awful stories, if they have any at all. And that's exactly the main problem with TNBA, because the changes were not always based upon storytelling, and instead they created a massive shift in the direction of the original show. The new Batman adventures dropped some of the most iconic visual elements from BTAS. The shadowy visual composition that was inspired by film noir was replaced by bright, contrasting colors to set a lighter tone and mood for the episodes. The darker red skies and twisted scenarios inspired by German Expressionism were replaced by more saturated and vibrant colors, with simpler designs, background and animation. And although the Art Deco architecture remained, the technology that existed in this new Gotham felt much more modern. The painted title cards for each episode of BTAS makes that show feel like a timeless work of art, a show that could have perfectly come out in the golden age of animation in the 1940s, with the modern artistic sensibilities of the 1980s, and adapting the greater Batman comic book mythology established in the 1970s. The darker tone of the stories, combined with groundbreaking character designs and faithfulness to the source material, created one of the most timeless superhero animated shows in history, and by removing all of that, the new Batman Adventures becomes just another superhero animated show of the 90s. But how did we get there? What happened between 1995 and 1997 that caused this massive downgrade in the eye of the public? To answer those questions, we have to go back to the beginning, to the man responsible for starting everything, to the one and only Superman. Over the course of history, Batman has always been playing catch-up with the Man of Steel. Superman was created in 1938, Batman was created 1 year later. Superman became the most popular comic book in the 1950s, so Batman became a Superman clone. Superman got his own TV show in the 1950s, Batman in the 1960s. Superman got his own movie in the 1970s, Batman in the 1980s. It wasn't until the 90s when the roles were reversed and Batman beat the Man of Steel and got his own successful animated series. But it wouldn't take long for the Man of Steel to follow suit, and only 1 year after the ending of Batman the Animated Series in 1986, Superman the Animated Series was released. What happened was that after the massive success of BTAS, Warner Bros. Assigned the same production team with the task of creating a Superman animated show, as they were planning to release a new Superman movie. Many people from the original crew of BTAS had left the studio by then, so it was up to producer Bruce Timm and writer Paul Dini to start working on Superman, and thanks to their experience working on Batman, they quickly came up with a whole new concept for the series. A new group of young creative people were brought in and guided by Bruce Timm and Paul Dini. They created a Superman show that was quite different from BTAS. The creative process, the animation, the stories, and the format of the episodes were approached from a completely different angle. Superman had always been a beacon of hope and brightness, so the new show needed to reflect that as well as adapt some of the most iconic elements of the Superman mythos. The new Superman show simplified the art style with fewer lines, textures and details, allowing for easier and better results in the animation department, and the show quickly acquired its own sense of identity. Superman the Animated Series premiered in 1996 on a completely different network. The original BTAS had been broadcasted by the Fox Kids Network, but by 1996 Warner Bros. Got their own kids network, and after the Superman show became a complete success, the network quickly renewed the series for a second season. But there was a caveat. They also wanted new episodes of Batman, with Batgirl as a permanent member of the team, because Batgirl was going to be featured in the new Batman and Robin movie. The studio wanted new Batman episodes to go alongside their new Batman movie, so they just asked the people in charge of the animated shows to make more Batman. But at this point, it's important to understand that the people in charge of these shows had spent a whole year creating a brand new animated show about a completely different character. Almost 5 years had passed since they started working on Batman, and they had not only gained a lot of experience, but they were also in very different stages of their creative and working lives. So when they were asked to create more Batman, they did it using all their knowledge and experience. This knowledge and experience allowed them to establish a new system to create the Superman episodes, and it was easier for them to make the new Batman episodes using that system. That's why the series didn't really have a proper name to begin with. While the working title of the show was Gotham Knight, they eventually settled for the new Batman Superman Adventures, because they were all part of the same production process, something that was only possible because the creators behind these shows had changed. They had grown and they had evolved, both as people as well as professionals of the animation industry. And that growth, that change is reflected in the work that they did in the new Batman Adventures.
We did Superman a few years after Batman, and in that time, we felt we had learned a lot of things about doing an hour, half-hour long adventure show.
What this show is really about is change. It's about evolution and growth. You can look at any element of the series and you will notice these things. The show started using digital animation as well as a distinctly different art style, creating a sharper, more dynamic and consistent look to the animation. This evolution and growth is even present in the little details like Officer Montoya becoming a police detective, or the Penguin becoming a legitimate businessman as the owner of the Iceberg Lounge. This show is full of such examples, but perhaps the embodiment, the perfect example of this change, this growth and evolution, is none other than Nightwing, because no other character had grown and changed so much as he did, encapsulating the essence of what the series is all about.
Hey, no one can be a boy wonder forever.
One of my personal favorite examples of this growth is the episode Double Talk, which is one of the most psychologically complex episodes of the show, exploring the darkest possibilities behind the concept of Scarface, one of my favorite Batman villains. This is the only episode that features surreal imagery in one of the most bizarre sequences that reinforces the twisted psyche of the ventriloquist and his relation with Scarface. This trippy and dark psychological exploration is almost like watching an episode of The Twilight Zone, where the uncanny becomes real, and we all enter the mind of the ventriloquist. This perspective allows us to understand Arnold Wesker, when he takes control of his life and finally outgrows his psychosis with a Scarface. It's one of my favorite episodes that I think most people sleep on, because it doesn't have a popular villain or a crazy action sequence. But that's what's so good about it, because it's one of the few episodes that is actually reminiscent of the style of BTAS. The psychological and human nature of the story combined with the dark imagery and horror elements could have absolutely worked in the style of BTAS, which is something very few episodes of TNBA can achieve. Another one of them is Cult of the Cat, an episode that is very reminiscent of the Batman stories from the 1970s, thanks to the pulp-style narrative, with exotic villains, dangerous cults of assassins, ancient castles away from Gotham, and epic showdowns with deadly death traps. This episode could also have worked in the old style of BTAS. And then there's Mean Seasons, the episode that introduces Calendar Girl, a variation of the classic Batman villain Calendar Man, and the new tragic character that is psychologically tormented by the way she perceives her own image as flawed and tainted, when in reality she is beautiful. This is the dark reality of many women around the world, and the concept of a woman alienated by the entertainment industry and forced to such extreme actions is something taken straight out of Baby Doll from BTAS. But Mean Seasons is just as effective and even more interesting, with a crazy action set piece with Batman fighting a dinosaur. Yes, the series is different, and that's not a bad thing. If anything, this version of Batman feels more defined than before. While Gotham City was previously surrounded by darkness that prevented us to see clearly how everything looked, this new version of Gotham feels more Gotham than before. The bright, vibrant red skies contrast beautifully with the black outline of buildings that we associate with Gotham City, a place that may look bright on the outside, but also a city full of dangerous places, dark alleyways and run-down, crime-ridden streets with poor and homeless people. These are constant scenes in almost every episode and provide a contrast between the ugly side of Gotham and the tall and glamorous buildings that guide our eyes towards the red skies above, where a beacon of light shines bright to fight away the darkness of the night. The main characters of Gotham have also been redefined, allowing the creators of the show to include other characters of the DC Universe to build upon this idea of a shared universe that has slowly started to become the DC Animated Universe, starting with the crossover episodes with Superman the Animated Series as part of the new Batman and Superman Adventures. The first of these crossovers being the three-part episode called World's Finest, which, in my opinion, is the best version of the first meeting between Batman and Superman, drawing a lot of inspiration from the classic World's Finest comics, and creating some of the best Batman and Superman dynamics ever put on screen. These episodes are extremely fun to watch, and I may be a bit biased here because back in 98 I got the VHS movie release of these episodes and I watched it more times than I can remember, but even watching them now, more than 20 years later, they still hold up incredibly well. From the ambitious storyline to the performances of the voice actors, the music, the animation, the direction, these episodes are the absolute best of both shows, and the subsequent crossovers between both series are just as good and interesting. And curiously enough, it's in these episodes that Batman feels more at home. This Batman feels like he belongs in this world, with Superman and Supergirl both showing up in Gotham, and Batman coming face to face against the likes of Brainiac and Lex Luthor. This Batman fits perfectly in this universe, and it makes sense, because this Batman was created as a result of the success of the Superman show. Both series were released on the Warner Kids Network, which allowed the creators a lot more creative freedom to tell the stories they wanted to tell. One of the most crucial elements that defined the style and storytelling of BTAS was the extensive censorship that it endured when the series was aired on the Fox network. These restrictions forced the creators to find ingenious and creative ways to tell the stories, which is why BTAS feels much more profound and more carefully crafted. On the other hand, the WB network provided the same creators with much more creative freedom, which is another reason why TNBA feels so strikingly different. But this freedom is also what allowed them to grow and develop their craft, evolving into something far different from what they had originally intended. It's because of this newfound freedom that they could come out from under the shadow of the Tim Burton Batman movie and became so confident with their work that they started to experiment with their stories, to the point that they created an episode like Critters, the episode where it's absolutely clear that the creator simply said, "Fuck it, let's do Adam West Batman." Critters is an episode that feels straight out of the 1960s, with Farmer Brown and his jacked up daughter resembling the plethora of bizarre villains that were created in the Batman TV show of the 1960s. The giant bugs and weird animals of this episode come straight out of the Silver Age of Batman comics, and the episode even features incredibly convenient gadgets, terrible puns, the necessary deadly death trap, all the way down to the holy catchphrase. When BTAS started, they wanted to stay as far away as possible from the campy version of Batman from the 1960s, but after exploring all the possibilities, they ended up going exactly down that road, coming full circle with Critters, something that I find absolutely amusing.
That's a lot of bull.
The way that Batman the Animated Series culminates in the new Batman Adventures is the best possible outcome, because one of the biggest problems with long-running animated TV shows is that they are never allowed to change or evolve. They are forever stuck with the same art style and designs, to the point where the later seasons become parodies of themselves. And thankfully, that was not the case with Batman. The creators of this show were still passionate about it, but they needed to keep things interesting for themselves, because, after all is said and done, this show, as well as BTAS, is art. Ever-changing, ever-evolving art. The creative people in charge of the show were artists, and every single artist is dedicated to improving their craft, to make their work better every single time. That is something that I can deeply relate to and understand. And that's why I think that asking creators to remain static and keep doing the same thing over and over is not only unfair to them, but also unrealistic. This show is about the evolution of art, the evolution of artists, and the evolution of us, the audiences, along with it. And that is the point of the new Batman Adventures. Another 90s superhero cartoon, sure, but one that defined the landscape of superhero animation in the 90s, and one that is still a pretty darn good Batman show. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you'd like to help me make more videos like this one, please take a look at my Patreon and be part of this awesome group of people. As always, a big thank you to all of my Patreons and channel members, and a special thanks to Thomas Murray. That's it for now, folks. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next one.